325 over there.
Okay, hello?
Hey, Shalom. How's it going?
I tried to call you because sometimes it's hard to reach me. So, but thank you for calling me back.
Yeah.
This is Joe.
I'm actually traveling on my in my conveyance down the New Jersey Turnpike, but I can still talk.
So can you talk right now, or yes or no?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, anyway, yeah. I'll call for two things. Number one is I'm a landlord. I've been a landlord for 20 years. Anyway, I have the worst tenants from hell. But anyway, they should be out soon. But this idiot hit me in my ear. He actually punched me, and he admitted that he said he slapped me, but the reality is he punched me. But anyway, he went to jail, but they didn't give him shit. I mean, I'm like, what? So I went and reviewed cases, you know, for that kind of, it's called assault. For that kind of assault, usually you get at least a month. Mostly you get like 6 months. I know he doesn't have a record, but is there anything that can be done to bring that case to give him a bigger penalty?
What was he actually charged with?
I think assault. But I looked in his record thing, and it looks like he got out the next day, and it looks like they dropped the charges. I could be wrong, but that's what I read.
So did you actually press charges against him?
Well, it was a citizen's arrest. But no, they didn't tell me anything. I don't know how to do that. So I assumed that they were going to, you know, they just did this on their own. The detective went and whatever, and they had court without me. I was going to go, but I had to do something else really important, so I didn't go.
Yeah, well, I don't know, you know, if they brought, like, criminal charges against him? Is that a criminal misdemeanor?
Yeah, because his bond was $20,000, which is not really that much. But and I don't know if he was bailed out, because I went to this website, and it didn't tell me that. You know, I looked in his record, and, you know.
Yeah, I mean, so what I would do, like, I can't really tell people what to do. What I would do, though.
If you were you, I understand.
Yeah, I would actually go down. The police should have actually taken a report. I would ask to look at, you know, the police report. And say, I would like to know the charges of this guy that actually assaulted me. Was it assault and battery, or was it just simple assault? You know, I would actually want to find out what that is first. I would see if he is only out because he, like, he's out on bail or something like that, and he still has to go to court.
Oh.
And then if not, I would bring my own civil suit against him, because you say he struck you. Well, if he hit me, and if he damaged, you know, he left any kind of mark on me. See, I don't know really about California. I know in the state of New York, if you leave a mark on someone, they got to arrest you. They will arrest you. And then you have an arraignment, and then pretty much the black robe is going to determine it. But if you try and pursue that on your own, it's going to become more like of a civil suit, where there's going to be like a monetary damage or, you know, any kind of damage you think that you may have actually underwent.
The problem is he has no money, and I don't think he's even working. I think he's workers' comp, so he's not really working. So he's not like,
you know, the only thing left that you can actually do is to look and see what, because in some situations, like worst-case scenario, usually for assault, you could spend anywhere. You know, they could fine you for maybe $1,000, and it could be anyway from maybe one day to about 30 days in jail, if it's not something serious, like with some kind of weapon. Because, you know, I don't know if he alleged, well, he hit me also. So then it becomes a hearsay thing if there's no witnesses, and it'd be like, you know, your word against his, a regular street fight.
No, in this case, I don't know if they'll believe him, but my brother and my mom were a witness, because they're visiting, and they'll testify that you know, and he admitted it, Pac. He said that the only thing is he lied. He said he slapped me. He did not slap me. He punched me. Okay?
Well, I mean, it doesn't matter whether he punched you or struck you. If he actually hit you, and, you know, you didn't want to be touched. I'll put it like that. he touched you, you don't want to be touched. Then, you know, he's actually violated you. And if, you know, if they list it as an assault, you know, I guess, you know, like other states, when you're dealing with the statutes, they'll tell you, like, if it, you know, what degree it is. Is it a simple assault, you know, and for what penalty that carries. So the only thing you can really do with that is look at, you know, the statutes in that state and see what it is for, like, assault, or if they render it simple assault.
Yeah, I was going to go down to the detective's office.
Right.
The other thing is, we had a restraining order against him, but he's not supposed to be at the house.
So if there was a restraining, now this is a whole different thing. If there was a restraining order against him and he wasn't supposed to be there, now he's in violation of the restraining order. So seeing that, he's actually in contempt of court. So if the black robe that issues that order is actually notified, then he is more likely to be locked up just for being in violation of that restraining order or whatever penalty this judge decide, you know, to hit him with.
Yes. Okay, so I'm going to go down maybe Monday or Tuesday and talk to the detective. So I know what detective it is. So he says, yeah, let me know if something happens. So I said, I will. So I told him I'll talk about it before on another case, and I didn't because I got really busy. I had to do, I'm trying to do this restriction, the unlawful detainer. So I've been real busy because I have an incompetent attorney. They keep messing up and they keep filing the wrong paperwork. So finally, they approved one of them, and I'm waiting for the writ soon.
Sure.
You know, and I'll be close now. But it just pisses me off because, you know, he did something really wrong, and he's out here like, you know, nothing happened to me, you know. And then I could have fought back. But look, I want to do this legally. I'm not in here to get in trouble. I'm not your kid anymore. I have a history of fighting a lot, and I'm an adult now. I can't do that anymore. Unless you would have hit me badly, and you know, I would have fought back. Trust me. But something like that, you know. I want to beat him in court, though. I really want to do. I don't really care about, you know, fighting. So, all right, I'll do that then. Okay, my other question then is, I'm doing A4V. I think that's what they call it. Accepted for rally, right? I think that's what they call it. And I'm learning how to do that. I've been, you know, watching your tapes and other people's tapes. And there's a few people that totally think it works 100%. But the problem seems to be enforcing it. Like, people will do it. Sometimes they'll enforce it. Sometimes they don't. So my question is it possible to enforce it correctly, or is there a way?
Well, I mean, what I know is that if you read, this is what most people have a tendency to look over. In order for me to accept something for value, and I have to be in accordance with House Joint Resolution 192 and Public Law 7310. So, so what that means is that it's not something that I'm making up or I'm taking something illegally. It's something that they actually put on the books in both of those, House Joint Resolution 192 and Public Law 7310, that tells me since the bankruptcy in 1933 that I could actually set off or discharge public debts. That's not something I made up. That's me paraphrasing that in their own words. So, I will say this. I've never had a problem with doing it myself. It's only certain people that, you know, they tried it and they say they had problems and so on and so forth. But here's one key thing to remember.
Okay.
If you try and do that and you are a debtor, which means you're in a corporate ward status or you're a ward of the state, that means you are essentially still property of the state.
Of the state,
and if you are property, you know, I'll use a phrase that it's easier to understand. That means you're a subject or you're a slave to the system. That might sound kind of harsh, but it's true. Because if I'm property, I can't own any other property, and I can't control any finances because I'm property. You know, just taking it back and looking at the black slaves or the indentured servants, you had an obligation to someone else, and you didn't have any you know, power or say so, or your word was irrelevant. So when I'm in a debtor status, That's how they're looking at me. So I can't go and do and accept it for value and expect that to work. Not, you know, according to their policies. So
okay.
The first thing that I will have to do to want to make sure that this works is make sure that I'm not in a corporate war status. That means I'm a creditor and not a debtor. And so the only way to do that is to undo these contracts that
okay.
I, you know, agreed to unknowingly.
Okay.
Because,
okay.
you know, most of us has actually, I would say 99% of the people are engaged in contracts and
yeah.
they're not even aware of, you know, the side effects, if you
okay.
will, of these contracts.
All right. Okay.
So in order, so for me, the A for V has actually worked every time. But then you'll
okay.
have people said, I tried it, it didn't work. It's because you didn't do what you were supposed to do. And I keep
okay.
telling people, law is specific. It's not
okay.
like, you know, you going, you know, writing some term paper or something for college and you get a few words wrong and, hey, well, I still pass. It doesn't work like that anymore. You could get one little thing off and then it's not going to work. If you don't do something right, it's not going to work. And from most people that I've actually interacted with that's done the acceptance for value,
okay,
I try to emphasize to them, listen, this is all about offer and acceptance. Offer
okay.
and acceptance. So one of the first things that I tell them that I did is that I went and I defined acceptance in law, in a black law's dictionary. So acceptance
okay.
actually forms a binding contract. It is an agreement.
Okay.
So understanding that word, I know that if I send off, because you got to think of an acceptance for value as in terms of like maybe a money order or something else, like some sort of, I guess, commercial presentment or like a, I'm basically saying, accept this right here for value until real money returns into circulation. Because with the seizure of, you know, gold and silver, there really hasn't really been no real money in circulation. They have Federal Reserve notes. See, all of this stuff is like imperative to understand, to truly understand why an acceptance for value should work if it's done right. So if there's no real money in the circulation, I make them my offer and say, hey, accept this for value. Since there's no real money in circulation, I'm, you know, giving you this until real money returns in the circulation. See, when you do an acceptance for value, you're doing the same thing that the GOV says. They give you Federal Reserve notes. And they
okay.
say, that's not money. Because if you look up the definition of money in law, it says it does not embrace notes. So a Federal
okay.
Reserve note can't be money. So what they're saying is, take this greenback, as a medium of exchange until real money returns into circulation. Essentially, they're doing the same thing that we the people are doing, but people are more reluctant to accept it from the government because there's a signature on it. And
yeah.
so they say, well, this is from the federal government. I'll take this. I'm not going to have any problem. You know, I could use this over here and here. But then when we go and do an acceptance for value, they be like, whose child's a doc? Why should I trust this? And so on and so forth. So if they act like that, that's when I say, well, here, have a look at House Short Resolution 192. I didn't write this. Have a look at Public Law 7310, and you will understand why I do this, and it does work. And then I'll tell them to read, and I make sure I understood UCC 3-603B. UCC 3-603B says that if a tender or payment is actually given to someone and they keep it, that is acceptance. And acceptance forms a binding contract. But if I offer a tender or payment to someone and they don't keep it, they've still been paid because I made them an offer. And whether they accept it or not, according to their own UCC codes, If I offered them a tender payment, even if they don't keep it, they've still been paid. I've still been able to sit off that debt according to their own house, their house joint resolution and their public law. And that's why it always worked to me, because if they send me something back, I know they're just making me an offer. Saying, well, we don't. Sometimes they've said to some people, we don't accept this type of payment.
Okay.
So, but they won't tell them, you can't do that. They say, we don't accept this type of payment. And so when they tell them that, the only thing they're doing to that person is making them an offer. And since the person don't really know how to respond to that, I will respond with, hey, Public Law 7310, the House Joint Resolution 192 says that you do, because you're on the public side. See, between you and I, it doesn't work that way, because you and I are actually on the private side. Say, you know, you have your apartment business or your house business that you rent out to people. If I want to rent a house from you, I can't pay you with an accepted for value, because you have your own private business. In order for me to try to do an accepted for value on something like that, it has to be a corporation, or it has to be some sort of GOV entity, because that who's they, it was those people, the banksters and the federal GOV that actually accumulated the debt and then decided to use us as a collateral.
Okay. All right. So basically, you quote the law, and if they say, oh, we don't, like you said, like we don't accept this, or we don't, whatever, we don't accept
this. That's what I've always done. But another mistake that I see people making, for whatever reason, they're sending their originals accepted for values in to the IRS. And it's because people, they go on the internet and they watch these fly-by-night, overnight sovereign gurus. They give them a lot of bad information. So, I mean, if you're sending it to the wrong place, how can you expect it to work anyways?
Oh, gotcha.
But you and then people go in dishonor. When they go in dishonor, that's when they call and say, oh, I need your help. I tried to accept it for value. It didn't work. Isn't that a little backwards? Shouldn't you get the knowledge first and then try and use it to make sure, you know, you're doing this correctly, instead of just, well, I'm going to go and try it. It didn't work. And hey, what do I do now? I'm in dishonor.
What does dishonor mean again? Didn't work. What does dishonor mean?
I'm sorry, what was that?
What does dishonor mean? Dishonor.
Oh, dishonor. That means, let's say, when someone goes to court and let's say if the court subpoenas me to come to court and I don't show, I just go into acquiescence. I just remain silent. I don't do anything. That means I'm in dishonor. Now, I'm more likely to lose because, in other words, things look unfavorable for me. My actions or my non-action cause things to look very negligible for me.
Yeah.
You know? So we always should try and stay in honor. You know, that means not arguing and so on and so forth. So when we do things, we're supposed to do them in like a spirit that, you know, although we're actually trying to teach the truth and educate people, that we do it in, you know, a very harmonious way, that we're not intentionally trying to be offensive and so on and so forth. Because if I tell you the truth and you get angry, I'm not teaching hate. I'm still teaching the truth. You just don't like the truth, so you get angry. See what I'm saying? So the way that we articulate things, we got to be mindful of that. Because if I'm trying to teach the truth and I'm doing it from a really demeaning spirit, then that's going to rub people the wrong way.
And when you send it, does what the stamp say, how much? Because there's a lot of people have different stamps. Does that matter much? Or
I wouldn't say that really means a lot, because it depends what it is that you're actually trying to do. See, if say for instance, if someone is trying to set off a loan or something like that, if I'm setting off a loan, I always did set off, settle, and closure. But if it's some reoccurring payment, I don't do it for settle and closure. If it's, you know, some month to month thing like that. But
sorry. What I was trying to do for this is my water bill. Just start off with that.
Now, I'm going to warn you, as I have people in the past, if someone is accepting for value a utility bill, I would be extremely careful with that.
Okay.
Case in point, there was a brother in New York. He was doing this, and it was working for him. He said, oh, yeah, I did it. It worked. But then, out of nowhere, his lights were shut off.
And, oh, really?
You know, he had done this for about 4 months, and then he said suddenly his lights just went off, and he called and say, why is my power disconnected? And, he, you know, he said, they told him, well, you didn't pay your bill. And he was like, what do you mean? That was actually discharged. And they said, well, we don't know. I mean, long story short, they act as if they never received anything from him. So he had to go through that whole process again. I'm trying to set it off and discharge it. So, I mean, they eventually, you know, discharged it again. But the question is, how many times will they play those kind of semantics like that or something like that? You see what I'm saying? So when people try and do that, I was like, hey, you might want to make sure if you try something like this that you have a backup plan and you don't have any children or anything living with you if it's in the dead of winter or something. You know?
Or have money to pay it off, cash, so you fix this or no? Can you just pay it using cash? You know what I mean? Just to delay it so you can work on this further?
Well, here's the thing. If I set something off, if I, you know, do a A for V, I'll usually send in like a cover letter explaining what I'm doing. Now, once I did that, what have I done? I've actually initiated a contract with them. Well, I've actually already had a contract, but I don't admit to actually owing anything because I don't see how I could actually owe anything because there's no real money. So I don't admit to owing anything. But once I do that, accept it for value, if I go back and pay cash, then I've actually terminated what I had with them, and I'm starting a whole new contract all over again. So that's the problem of me going to pay with cash once I've actually done the acceptance of value. It's like you're reinitiating a contract. Same thing on a credit card bill. If I'm setting it off, if I'm discharging it, and they could get me to pay $1, I've actually recontracted with them.
Yeah. Yeah, so that puts it in a damn.
And the other thing.
So that's the problem with the water bill. What's a one-time payment for? What can you use A4V for besides the water and gas?
Well, I've actually used it to set off a loan on a car, and I've used it to set off a student loan. That's me personally. But other people has actually used it for other things. I know one brother that set off $40,000 in child support. So when people tell me that it doesn't work, well, I contend that it does. And when they tell me it doesn't work, I believe that it's something that they've done wrong. But this is what people have to consider. You know, the forces that be is not going to sit down and tell you, okay, well, yeah, you could do this. You could discharge these debts and so on and so forth. Because so many people are going to be out of a job. And people know that they can actually go around and just set off things and discharge things because of the public debt, then, hey, they wouldn't be able to live the lifestyles that they're living. So the key element is to keep the sleeping giants asleep. Do not let too many people wake up. So when you try this, it's, you know, intended for there to be some sort of challenge. Because what usually happens is once they challenge someone, they start to lose faith, they start to lose hope, and then they back out and they give up. And that's what the system wants.
Okay. Wow. have to think about it, because then my cars are all paid off. My, you know, grandma,
right.
Kids.
Yeah, I mean, this is not for everybody, but
yeah.
I'm not cut from the same cloth as everyone
yeah.
else. You know, I believe that in order to, like, you know, inspire mm-hmm. change, like some of us is actually going to have to, you know, be on the front line. Like me, I'm a vanguard. I'm on the front line taking all of the chances and, you know, experiencing this. Most of what I'm saying, I'm actually speaking from direct experiences that I personally, you know, done
mm-hmm.
myself. Not like some theoretical speaking, but,
yeah.
you know, from real life experience.
Yeah. Damn. No, because I've had success. I mean, I've had parking tickets. I've got three already. Number four is coming. I haven't paid off my mortgage in 4 years. So I've learned stuff like
right.
this. So, but I try it. But first, I try to do my homework as much as I can. And then I hire people like you that are, know what they're doing. And they, you know, combination of that plus my own knowledge, and that tends to work. And I'm very persistent. Like, it might not work the first time, but then I look at it from a different angle or a different perspective, and it works. You know what I mean?
Right.
So I'm kind of like you are, but you probably know more than me. But I'm just saying, that's why I try to talk to people like you that have done it and have the experience. So, because it's much easier having someone like you help me. You know what I mean? Because I could do this on my own with no help, but I'm sure I'll probably do it, but I'd rather cut some of the time there, you know? I could save time and a little bit of less worry, you know? So, wow.
Yeah, I mean, the key thing is you don't know how they're going to respond. I can't
yeah.
say that I actually ever done this process and anyone sent me anything back. It always went through the first time for me. I don't know. And then, you know, some people tried the same thing, and, you know, they got some sort of counteroffer. And, you know, so this is why people got to understand what a counteroffer is. It doesn't really matter what language is written in. They're making you a counteroffer. You made
yeah.
them an offer to accept this for value. They're making you a counteroffer. So
yeah.
how are you going to respond to the counteroffer? You're going to go in acquiescence, get afraid, because, I, you know, I know one guy, you know, he done this on a student loan. And
okay.
then an attorney responded and say, you know, you may spend up to 200, 2 years in jail and up
yeah.
to $5,000 in fines and so on and so forth. And so the guy went into a panic, and then he reached out. So,
right.
you know, he had, you know, initially done all of this on his own, but apparently
yeah.
he didn't do something right. And then when that attorney made him that counteroffer, hey, he just, like, got frantic and freaked
yeah.
out. And, you know, hey, I don't know what to do. Or, hey, it's just an offer.
Okay. But he could have gotten out of that one, though.
Yeah.
Huh? Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, with that, I probably should get off. I seen a couple of troopers going by pulling people over. I'm sure they would love to pull me over.
All right. I'll let
yeah.
you go then. Nice talking to you. I'm going to think about this. All right.
All right. All right. Have
Take
a good
care.
Day.
Take care. Bye. Bye.
Yeah, sure.